job. We just appreciate them for their work sake. Of course, we don't want to leave out the sisters, amen?
Amen.
Amen. We're just so thankful for godly sisters and the wonderful way in which God has blessed this fellowship to have faithful men and women of God. We read 1 Timothy 3, verses 14 through 16 as a contextual backdrop to the study. I want to focus our attention on 1 John right now. Let's go to 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through verse number 3. When you have it, just say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's read this together. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come, and even now. Right now, look at your text, and I want you to, if you would, underscore or make highlight of every spirit, verse number 2. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. That's in your Bible, say amen. And then look at verse number 3, you have a contrast. And every spirit that confesses what? Not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is what? And you see that contrast? There's a stark reality that if you accept Jesus in the flesh, you've got the Spirit of God. But now if you deny that Jesus has come in the flesh, you do not possess the Spirit of God. Y'all see that?
Amen.
All right, then, if you would repeat after me, the undercover,
boss.
The undercover boss. Find a nearby
neighbor
and say,
neighbor,
I'm thankful
that we know
who the undercover boss is. Now shake somebody's hand and tell them it's good to see you on Sunday night. Amen. Amen. Well, when we reach that city of unlimited rivers of love, we'll sing hallelujah, hallelujah, high and high. Father, the ransom singers will together lift that hymn to glory. We'll sing hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, day we will be in that land. And I'm just thankful that we can catch that tune on this side. Amen. We have something to smile about. We have something to praise God for. Even when life seems to turn on us, there is something better on the other side. Hallelujah. In the house of God. Well, the undercover boss. The undercover boss. John, the beloved of Jesus and apostle of Jesus Christ, has well articulated that no doubt, for sure, with absolute certainty, for real though, showed up. Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. And Paul said that God manifested himself in the flesh. John and Paul are in agreement that Jesus really did come. So much so that John takes the sturdy and sound position to say that anybody who denies that God came by Jesus in the flesh, if they deny Jesus in the flesh, then they have not the Spirit of God. The question then becomes, since there's no doubt that he came in the flesh, someone says, well, how do you know you weren't there to see him? I do not have to be there to see him, because John saw it. Amen, somebody. Matthew saw him. Amen. Mark saw him. Thomas saw him. Paul saw him out of season. And my faith tells me that he came. And it is because of the faith in God and the plan of God that we can smile here on this day. Had Jesus not come, there is no reason of our gathering. Had Jesus not come, there is no reason of our singing praises. But we sing praises because he came. And I'm thankful to God for his coming. I'm thankful to God for the advent. I'm thankful to God for the incarnation called Jesus Christ. Now, this morning, we spoke from one point, the undercover boss. And I will not rehash the background, but the undercover boss is the senior executive who goes into the company to do some investigation, trying to get a pulse on the company, trying to see what works and what does not work, trying to collect the pros and the cons, wanting to understand what is positive about the company and what is negative and needs to be improved. Of course, we understand in order to do this, he had to conceal himself. And just like the CEOs of this world, corporations have to conceal themselves to find more about their own company, God sent Jesus, wrapped himself in human flesh, concealing, amen, himself in human flesh so that he could get close enough to his creation to understand, here it is, really empathize with the needs of all mankind. And I'm thankful for the concealment And I'm also thankful on tonight for the concern of the undercover boss. Every undercover boss who goes undercover, who goes in disguise, who goes cloaked, for those who are working with him to not recognize him, is doing it because they are concerned. Now, the Bible says that when God manifested himself in the flesh, the Bible indicates to us that he wanted to walk among men so that he could become our advocate. I know that's right because of what John says in John, 1 John 2. Look at verse number 1. The Bible, the Word of God reads, "My little children, these things write I unto you, that you what? Sin not. And if any man sin, we have what? An advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous." Is that in your Bible? We have an advocate. We have someone who can speak to our needs because he understands. Jesus does not have sympathy for us, but he has empathy for us. Please understand and do not confuse the two concepts, because sympathy and empathy are not exactly the same. Amen, somebody. You see, a person can have sympathy, and that means that they are expressing their feelings. They can have sympathy, and that means that they are expressing their concern. But when we have empathy, it means that not only do we express our feelings, but we can actually feel what the other person feels. Amen, somebody. We can feel what the other person feels. Now, the only way you can truly feel what somebody else feels, you have to go through that same situation for yourself. Am I right about it? Somebody ought to help me preach this one tonight. I say, I need a person, not who just sympathizes, but I need someone who can empathize. I don't need someone who can just say I'm sorry. I need someone who can walk in my shoes to understand the heavy burden of life and the trouble of life and the trials of life and the tribulation of life. Jesus wasn't a person who sympathized. Jesus is a person who empathizes. It means to identify. Amen, someone. It means to identify. When John says that Jesus is our advocate, it means that Jesus can plead our case. Hallelujah. I'm grateful that I have a Savior who can not only communicate to the Father, but he has to help strengthen your faith. I'm thankful that we have an advocate.
Amen. He can plead my case. Hallelujah, somebody. There's one thing about me pleading my case, but I have somebody else who sits a little higher than I sit, who can identify, the Bible says, who fought in my robbery to be equal with God. Am I right about it? He's the Word of God made flesh. He's the one of whom the whole family in heaven is named after. That's my advocate. He can do it because he is a God of compassion. He's a boss of compassion. Wouldn't it be wonderful if your physical boss referred to him as a boss, you may want to refer to him as a supervisor. I don't know. But whoever is your supervisor, wouldn't it be wonderful if they could just do your job for one day? Amen, somebody. Amen. You wish that. Somebody prayed that. Somebody has prayed that. Let him see what it's like to walk in these shoes. Always send me an email. Always, amen, send it over some work for me to do. Let him see, Lord, that my job is difficult. Come into the workplace on Monday and you have one job. And by Friday, you had 10,000 other jobs. They're always piling on you. That's a person who doesn't understand what you go through. That's a person who has not walked in your shoes, and so therefore, they don't understand the heavy burden and stress that you're under. Or perhaps they were where you were or where you are, but they have been elevated and they've forgotten from which you come. You ever seen folks like that too? They get a little title, amen, they get a little nameplate, amen. The story was told one time about an usher, who wasn't an usher, but he was ushering, and so leadership came to him and said, you're a good usher. He didn't have the official title as an usher, but they said, you're a good usher because you're doing the work of an usher. And they said, we're going to officially give you the position of a lead usher. And that man has served in that position faithfully with no fanfare for years. And then the next Sunday, after they made him lead usher, he came back with a name tag. Come on, right about. His name on it and had some powerful wings. Amen. He was lead usher now. And came back with a baton. Amen. Somebody. He had a pointer now. Am I right or not? He came back with some gloves. He lead usher now. And you got to be careful about folk who get wrapped up in the title. Am I right or not? But the title is about service. Yeah. Hello, somebody. Next time I check up on him, Brother Kelly, he's not going to say, well done, thou good and faithful preacher. He's not going to say, well done, thou good and faithful minister. He's not going to say, well done, thou good and faithful evangelist. He's going to say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. He's not going to say, well done, thou good and faithful doctor. He's not going to say, well done, thou good and faithful bishop.
Yeah, yeah.
Everybody in here is a servant. Yeah. And that's right about it. I'm a servant. And so I can't get wrapped up in the position. Amen. Because you don't know positions change.
Well,
am I right about it? You have the job you have right now, but positions change. Amen, somebody. You know, that's a good preaching right there. Amen. Amen. That's a good preaching right there. But that's nowhere in my notes. he's an African. Brother says, stay with it. He's an African. All right. And he has compassion. That's what I'm talking about. All right. So Matthew, get for me Matthew. Someone get for me Matthew. Let's show you the compassion of Christ, the compassion of the undercover boss. Matthew 9, look at verse number 35. Matthew 9, verse 35. The Bible says what?
And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people.
Read.
But when he saw the multitude, he was moved with compassion on them,
with compassion,
because they fainted and were scattered abroad.
Read.
And sheep have no shepherd.
Read.
Then said he unto his disciples,
read,
the harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are
few.
Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into his harvest.
Now watch this, watch this. When the undercover boss got down to the assembly line, he saw folk on the line who were confused. The Bible says that he looked upon the people and they were wondering, as sheep having, here it is, no shepherd. This is amazing. It is amazing for the fact that Jesus is moved with compassion, Brother Bailey. He's moved with compassion. Now, watch this. Moved with compassion, although he's in the flesh, he's still the Son of God. So he has, watch this, he has the concealment of the flesh, but he's still carrying the power of the Son of God. And he sees, as the undercover boss, things that they need that they are unable to provide for themselves. The undercover boss sees what is needed in the company, but what makes it an amazing adventure is that he is the one who can do something about the needs of the people. But yet the people are walking with him and they don't even know that in order for their needs to be met, they're walking with the one they're looking for. They're talking to the one they've been talking about because he's the undercover boss. In other words, it's as if the CEO came down and he sees exactly where the downfall is. He does not have to, amen, get angry and, amen, come down on the people for what they need to do. No, he's moved with compassion because he sees some things that they can't even see. And I'm thankful that we have the kind of undercover boss who sees that we need strength. He sees that we need faith. He sees that we need another chance. And so he does not take his mercy from us. He does not withhold his grace from us because he sees what we need when we can't see it. So he's moved with compassion. Notice the one who recognizes that they need a shepherd. He himself is the good shepherd. Am I right about it? John 10, verse number 9. Jesus Christ is what? The good. He's the good shepherd. Matthew 14. Matthew 14, verse number 13. Matthew 14, verse number 13. We're talking about him being concerned. He moved with compassion. Jesus' whole ministry was compassion-based. Read, Bible says,
when Jesus heard of it, he departed thence by ship into a desert place apart. And when the people had heard thereof, they followed him on foot out of the city.
Read.
And Jesus went forward and saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion. And he was moved
them with compassion
and healed their sick.
And watch it. He healed the sick. You see, the undercover boss can meet me at my need. And the way he can meet me at my need is because he emptied himself and then walked among us to understand what it is that we're going through. Who has humility to leave the convenient cubicle of Wall Street to come down to the lower factory level, to take up on a job that requires sweat and time and energy. But he did it because he was concerned. Oh, pray God that we get this. Our undercover boss was concealed and he was concerned. And when he saw where he could help us, he filled our every need. I'm thankful that I have someone who's my Savior, that when I fall short, he's able to pick up the slack. I'm so thankful that there are areas where I fall short, and wherever I fall short, he's able to pick up the slack. If I fall short in love, Jesus is able to give me what I need. I don't have it in myself to love folk who don't love me. But when I think about Jesus and see Jesus, then Jesus gives me the love in my life that I lack. If I come from a family that was broken and dysfunctional, Jesus has the way of giving me the wholeness that I need so that I can build upon what my family has not done and not allow the vicious cycle to repeat itself. Because God saw my need and Jesus meets my every need. He feels my all in all. Whatever you are going through, whatever you are experiencing, whatever you've been up against, you have a Savior. You have an undercover boss who will meet you because he is concerned. He'll meet you at your need. He'll meet you at your need. And this is why it's so important to be in the body of Christ. It's so important to be in the body of Christ. Because the same undercover boss who came once before, one day he's coming back. And what you want to do is you want to know him right now. I need to know him right now. Amen. While he's my advocate. Because the next time he comes, he will be my judge. Am I right about it? And so, everything I do, I want to do it to give praise to the undercover boss. Now watch this. Watch this. He was undercover then, but he's not undercover now. Bible says that ages and generations did not know, but now it's made known to us, those who are the saints. We know who he is. And so therefore, every time someone sees us, every time someone encounters us, they ought to get a glimpse of the boss. Yeah, they ought to get a glimpse of the boss, because when you spend time with the boss, there are some things that begin to rub off on you. Joy rubs off on the saint that's been in the company of the Savior. Am I right about it? Hope rubs off on the saint who has sat with the Savior. And I'm so thankful that our undercover boss has given us some things to make it in this world. Because right now, he's our advocate. And I'm thankful for the concealment, but praise God, I thank God for the concern. When you really consider the fact that Jesus is concerned about us, oh, come on. I know right now we're smelling good, looking good. Amen. We put a lot of stuff on, we took a lot of stuff off. I get all that. But y'all, listen. If you listen, God can see you naked. You do know that, right? I can't put on enough to cover up my shortcomings. I can't put on enough to cover up my failures. God sees all of that, and yet he still loves me. Amen. We don't even know all of our shortcomings. We got a hunch on a few things, and we can hardly get along with that. God sees everything that's wrong, yet he still loves us. He is the undercover boss. His name is Jesus. Stand to your feet. Someone say yes to Jesus. Believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Repent of all of your sins and confess the sweetest name on mortal tongue. Go down into the watery grave of baptism for the remission of your sins, that he might add you to the body of Christ. The gospel is the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus, and we know that Jesus got up again, and he's alive forevermore, he said. Not only is he alive forevermore, but when he got up, it means that now we can get up. Amen. Because what the Savior accomplished on his mission, he now has granted and transferred the same ability for us to get up again. Roman writer says, just like Jesus was raised, we'll be raised. He is our undercover boss. Will you come as together we sing?
There's a mountain great for you, and he has faced all rage to his grave. It is the fount of love and the source of love, and he gives us all free.
What a